All right, so maybe you should start. So good morning. Thank you for being here, attending the talk. Today I will be presenting an analytical solution on top of Hadoop developed at IBM Global Business Services. So as a matter of fact, the solution is called MetroPulse. It's about enhancing decision-making process with hyperlocal data. So hyperlocal data is everything that you can use around a particular point, a geographical point. These points, usually you have like your stores or your branches, if you're a bank, or you can have ATMs or vending machines or hospitals, whatever it is, right? Whatever business you are. So we'll be seeing several use cases for multiple industries. We'll see how geographical hierarchies, external metrics, all come together on a map, how we leverage all of them. Then we see how we integrate external and customer-specific metrics. And that is where the magic happens. That's where we have synergy between the external, the local data, the hyperlocal data, and the customer data, right? Then we see the solution architect, the microservices for data ingest and curation. This is a new trend that's going on with Hadoop, having several small pieces, small jobs that you can use at will to build up your solution, reducing, accelerating deployment time, right? So I'm pretty sure that you all are interested in how to make shorter time for deploying your solutions. Then we'll see the technological components that we use for the solution and a sample of the dashboards. So what's the problem that we are solving here? So in general, right, when companies do demand forecast, market campaign, distribution plans, they use aggregated data. They take a region or several stores and aggregate in order to create those metrics. Right there, you can have a problem, right, because you are losing accuracy, making average. Not only that, but when a company goes lower level and make forecasts at the store level, in this case, we are talking about stores, usually they don't consider what is happening around the stores. So they lose the opportunity to be more accurate in terms of forecast, in terms of metrics. You may be overstocking some products, understocking another product, just because you don't know what is happening around each store. So how can we do that? How can we leverage all this data around the stores or around ATM machines in order to make it better, better forecasts and accuracy in general? We start using hyperlocal data like demographics. Demographics, people already have been using demographics for a while, but not very precise, usually for large areas. What we are targeting here is very precise, a few blocks around you are. Right, to know exactly what is going on, how much you're going to need in terms of products, in terms of demand. Another one is weather. So it's not just that the average temperature for the month is going to be this much. We are talking about it's going to be raining tomorrow afternoon. What's the temperature tomorrow at 1 p.m.? So that level of granularity, it makes a whole lot of difference in terms of precision in forecast. Social media sentiment analysis. What are people talking about you, your store in particular, this one, about some product that you have right there, right? So precise feedback being used right away. Economics. Is there any driver, anything happening around a particular store that is driving demand, more business, or maybe reducing business? Should we be considering that when you forecast? Events. Is there anything happening around the store? For example, a new show, or there is a construction starting next Monday that's going to take a full month. The construction will preclude your customers to access the store during that month. It will reduce flow. So are you accounting for that? Maybe you should. So that's why we meant by events. And another example, subway stations. When you group your stores and you do the analysis, are you considering that next to one store you have a big subway station, next to another one you don't? So you should maybe not treating them in the same way, right? And you can have thousands of them, several different metrics being provided, most of them free by the city, by the local authorities that you can be using, combining, right, and take advantage, not take advantage, but leveraging on your benefit. Right? So what's next? Once you have that, you look at the surroundings, the neighborhood of the store, and then capture what is going on. And then you aggregate them, right? I mean, list them, overlap, and start to leverage this. There are two points here that are important. One is, by the simple fact that they overlap all the layers, you can, by inspection, detect problems. If you guys attended the gentleman yesterday talking about insurance from Progressive, he mentioned that, exactly that. Just by visualization, he could detect problems in his customers' cars. Here, too, we can detect what is going on with your business just by inspection when you overlap all those layers. Another point is, if you combine all those external metrics and the internal metrics, customer-specific, you can have tremendous synergy making them available for consumption by the data scientists. And then you can develop advanced analytics on top of all of them together, already integrated. Right? So in your mind, the question now is, does it work? Is it worth to put them together? How much benefit? We kind of understand, yeah, it looks like it is going to be good, but how much, right? Is that worth doing this? So this is a picture coming from an article. Oh, I'm sorry. Where is the laser? Yeah. So this article was published by some colleagues at TJ Watson IBM Research Center, and it's 1 week old. Results were just published last week, last Wednesday. They presented in New York in this conference. And here you have the bars are the actuals for bottled water for this store in a customer we have. So this is actuals. The blue line are traditional methods, not considering external metrics, right? Not considering the surroundings. And you can see that it more or less predicted the average if you consider the average of the bars, right? So these are traditional methods, not using surroundings. And then the red line are using external metrics. And you can see that it's way closer to the actuals. Actually, about 24% better in accuracy. 24%. Imagine your forecast of everything, all your metrics, 24% better. This easily translates to millions and tens of millions of dollars per year, depending on size of your operations. Right? So it's definitely worth following this kind of solution. It's not working. Ah, OK. So let's see some use case now. In this case, it's still in retail industry. Let's imagine that you want to identify low and high performers and take actions to improve the performance of the low performers. So you have a city, and the color here means the surroundings are the same. Every region having the same color, they are similar based on external metrics. Then you position your stores. Same color means the stores are similar, right? So same colors for the circles and same color for the regions, they are all the same, very similar. And then you do it, for example, purple, maybe mega stores as opposed to regular stores, and you do that for all of them. Once you have it, you can group now considering similar regions with similar stores. And you group and rank the performers from the top to the worst guy. Now you can compare what's the difference in performance from the worst to the best, your baseline. If you add up, it's not working. Yeah, okay. So if you add up this difference, this is how much money you are leaving on the table, right? So if you realize what is making this guy that has similar stores, similar operations in a similar region, operating in such a low level comparing to the top, this is how much money, if you add those, you are leaving on the table. So what you can do is you can go after these guys and figure out, am I leaving something? I mean, did I miss anything in terms of how these guys are operating, or is just bad management or just luck, right? So you can figure that out and try to optimize the total revenue for all the stores. And you can do that for the full aggregation or product by product, category by category, whatever is important for you, right? So that would definitely increase dramatically total revenue in your understanding of your business, because you are considering truly what is important for revenue. So micro-segmentation plus external metrics, much higher accuracy, and root cause analysis. So another example here, now in Dallas region, you have another store, some region, some point. So so what's going on? Why it's not working? All right. So here, you have not only the store, but you know how many people are coming from different regions. So that's what we call population movement. So we have a supplier who analyzes what their customers are doing with the app. So they track and monitor where people are, what they are doing with apps. And using this, they know where people go during the day. So we can, if we provide one latitude longitude point, we can know where people are coming from. And we know where they live, where they work, right? So you can use this to start asking questions like, these guys are really close to the store, but only 5% here is going to the store. Why? What's going on, right? You can start looking at a much deeper level of analysis. Another point is, for these guys are coming from far away, maybe there is a potential for another store over here, right? So not only that, but this is just a latitude longitude. You can put your competitor's latitude longitude there. That would provide a much more interesting kind of analysis. Because now you can compare this kind of profile, where they are coming from, against your store and your competitor's stores. If the profile is different, substantially different, clearly there is something else other than just position and geography. Your process is different. If it's better, good. If it's not, you can improve because you identify what's going on, right? So another possibility of this use case is for seat planning. You have all the traffic, how it's growing, population movement during the day, how population is growing over time. But you know the precise route that they use to move from one place to another. You can position emergency services around the route, along the route. You can place advertisement because you know the population demographics. You know where people are going during the day. Right? Far more accurate. You can have market campaigns, more precise. You know the interest of each region because you know where they are going using this percentage. And you know population density, so you can target more precisely where you're going to spend money. Right? So these are all derived from combination of hyperlocal data with your metrics. Okay. So let's see a use case in telecommunication. So let's assume this is a region, and we have one metric here that's congestion. Very common, right? Very important for telco. So high congested area, low congested, medium congested area. So where to put a new cell phone tower? This is extremely important for telco, and they spend billions of dollars on this every year, right? So extremely important because congestion is correlated to attrition, and you don't want to lose money, losing customers, right? So you don't lose any customer. So the intuition says, well, if we high congested area, I should put a new tower right there. That's the intuition. However, if you consider, for example, affluent houses, this is correlated to lifetime revenue. Lifetime revenue is how much money you make in the entire lifetime of the customer, and you want to maximize it, right? So affluent houses are related to lifetime revenue. If you see here, this is median, right? So median and low affluent house. So high affluent house is related to where you want to keep your money. You don't want churn there. So these guys, although it's median congestion, they have where the money is. So it's certainly better. It's better to consider a new tower over here that would definitely reduce churn of your high lifetime revenue customers. Right? So it's not intuitive, but certainly makes a lot more sense from revenue perspective. So another example would be if you are back to the initial condition and you realize that there will be a band performing in this area that is already congested. So the area is already congested, you have a band performing, will bring thousands, tens of thousands of people there. So the tower will collapse. So what the company can do? They can move a mobile tower there and solve the problem for that Saturday evening. So just because the company now has on the screen automatically showing up events that they may not be aware of, they could solve the problem in a relatively simple way, avoiding bad quality performance over there. Right? So that's another example. So in terms of use case, you have many, right? So all different industries for bank, for example, cash, the second of cash demand forecasting. You don't want to leave a lot of cash in the ATMs if people are not consuming. We are talking about cash, right? So you can predict how much cash is going to be necessary for each ATM in a much better way using hyperlocal metrics. Another one, another problem that I worked some time ago for a hospital. And the idea was to predict how many nurses and doctors would be necessary over time. So every time that we have a snowstorm coming, this kind of bad weather or something abnormal, clearly the number of doctors and nurses necessary at the hospital would be different. So they could better predict who would be off or not, right? Depend on the weather and external events. So how we put this together? You have geography hierarchy, external metrics, and polygons. How does that work? So this is a sample of a map from New York. So here you have real map being represented by polygons. And this is available by the cities. So many cities around the world, they provide this data. It's already there sitting. You just need to upload, right? So these files, they are based on lists of polygons. Each polygon has a list of vertices. So you upload this. Once you have it, they are associated to leaf level of hierarchies. New York is a big one. So you usually have this root level, city name, and intermediate levels with the regions. And then at the lower level, the leaf level, you have all the polygons associated to each one. So once you have it, now you have two types of metrics. If the metric already has a latitude, longitude, for example, the temperature at this weather station is 72 degrees. So we can extrapolate that to the polygon, entire polygon. Another possibility is when the metric does not have a lat long point. For example, it's raining in Queens. So Queens, it's up here. There is no polygon. But we propagate down and cover the entire region here. So in this way, we can have all the cities uploaded. We can have them mapped to the metrics available and ready to be reused. So, and this is where the magic happens. The left side is what I just explained. It's one for all the cities around the world, as many as we can load. The right side changes for each customer. right? So we just need to upload specific metrics for the customer. And once we have it, the prime entity, that means the stores or the towers, the ATMs, they have a lat long. They map to one of those polygons and immediately would inherit the metrics associated to the polygons. And you can use it to your models right away. And we already have several of the models too. So you can rerun the models using all these external metrics in a very simple way now. So this is what we call MetroPulse solution. So let's talk about the lower level in terms of what are doing internally in the solution. So one of the parts is about polygon functions. So we use this all over. Given a lat long, where that particular point resides, right? So we have to find it. So that's one algorithm that we are using. This one is simple. We already have available in Python libraries. There are more interesting ones, like this one. You cannot have overlap of polygons. If one store resides on an overlap, it would cause all sorts of problems, right? Because that's not true. So you have double counts and misleading information. So that's another one that we are using. Even more interesting is this one, when you have your reference polygon and then you receive a metric based on something else. That is not good, right? Imagine that you have a metric based on zip code, and now you have another one based on census. It's a different kind of polygon. So what do you do, right? So we need to remap. So there are two types of metrics here, like counts, population. You check how many or what's the percentage of the blue on top of your target polygon, and then take it from the blue and do the same for purple and red, and then you sum up. The other kind of metric is like temperature, right? You take how much of your target polygon, this part, is at 72 degrees or is at 82 degrees, and then you do the average. So that's how you map from the old one to the new one. So this is time consuming, right? You are dealing with thousands of polygons and doing this for each one of them. So that is clearly a big data context because you need to run this in parallel to be efficient. So let's see the architecture of this. So we have on the left side, we are receiving data from all these different types of sources that we load to our internal landing zone. Then we add geographic boundaries, polygons, and hierarchies to this, and have everything ready for consumption. At this point, we on the right side, we have this analytics workbench, is where we integrate internal data with external data. And we replicate that for different customers. And the customers could be on the cloud, or could be on-premise, right? And we feed only with relevant cities for that particular customer. The other option is the customer would only need the raw data, not the integration. And then the customer could consume data via an API. So that is the overall architecture. In a lower level, we have the external data being loaded in an internal zone, loaded to Hadoop. We process using Elasticsearch, Phoenix, Python, Spark, right? And then we load to HBase at the end. That can be accessed via API using nodes. I think it's maybe the batteries. All right, so next step is we load the internal data to the ingestion zone. And then we do it again. We combine both using Hadoop and reload to HBase using the same set of tools, right? Once that is done, then we have the data scientists working and developing core analytics. Core analytics are like the ones related to geometry that we are dealing with polygons, right? And then we have another layer of analytics here where our data scientists and the customer data scientists can develop business models for business problems, right? Once that is done, then we upload or publish to the performance layer. So we have two isolated clusters here, one for Cassandra, one for Redis, and they are dedicated just for performance. So we don't mix up heavy duty load here on top of Hadoop with the Cassandra and Redis that are dedicated for performance, right? And then once that is done, we can consume via the API, data as a service, or we feed the dashboards on D3. So one point about this architecture is old customers, old IBM customers would be surprised seeing an IBM solution with 100% open source, right? So there is no IBM here, it's all open source. Very good. So what's next? So in terms of the flow, internal flow, we have the internal data being loaded to stage, HDFS, transforming from raw, clean, validated, and tabular. Tabular becomes ready for integration. That's why we went with tabular internally. Similarly, for external data, stage, and then we clean, validate, and create in tabular as well. We integrate. From the integrated data, then we create the core analytics and developing the models over here. And then once we have output ready to go, we derive data, consume data, and then we publish to the dashboard. So can you move? It's not working. Yeah. So each one of those in red became a microservice for ingestion, internal data, external data, the publisher for the performance layer, and even visualization. So those were derived from the project, and now we are using as the base to create our library of microservices. So this, in particular, I think everybody would be interested in this, right? Having something like that. Because here you have the standard Hadoop, you have the standard Hadoop input, so all the different types of input data, the ingestion engine, right? So you get the data out, move into Hadoop, process it, and then transform as needed and store for analysis. So this is our library of microservices now, and you can pick and choose as we have more projects. So probably every company would be interested in developing this kind of microservice because it would expedite the process that you develop new projects. Okay, so a little bit in terms of the method to work with relational and NoSQL database. On the left, we used relational thinking and design in order to understand what we need to do. So that's very good, right? You have the one to many, many to many, many to one. So that clearly defines how entities are interrelated. But when you go for implementation, you need to adapt. You need to change it. And don't just implement one to one, but we combine tables in order to make it adequate for the technology that you are using, right? In this case, we are using HBase. Right? So we combine tables and create different ones specific for each base. So I think this is very typical. Everybody probably has some kind of hierarchy, right, in your environment. And we are using the row key as the level. We start like in London, the city name or Paris, and then we go to a lower level. Every level you have specific attributes for that level. At the city level, you may have a mayor, but at a regional level, you don't. So you have different attributes that you can clearly, easily load to HBase. And then you have all the polygons associated to that level. So when you are on the interface, on the dashboards, If you click one level, you immediately have all the polygons and vertices associated to that level. So it's really fast, right? So Flume, we are using Flume to connect between the database and our analytical workbench in different customers. So we have, from here, we have external data. We create one folder and one agent for each type of source, create identical agent on the other side, on the customer side. Each one is processed on HDFS and stored on HBase. Right? Why did we do that? Okay, so first thing is, one data source per agent is very easy to add a new data source. So you don't need to change anything on the agent, you just add another one, right? The other is, agents can be optimally configured according to the data source, maybe because of the frequency, maybe the size of the file, so you can adjust the agent to handle different data source. Agents write to different HDFS folders. So every source will go to a different folder, and that avoids conflict. Because there is only one agent to write to the folder, you can write all the agents in parallel. There is no conflict to HDFS. Each one will go to HBase as a column family. So every source becomes a column family. You can put as many attributes as you want in the column family. So you leverage HBase because of flexibility to add the new column families at will. That means sources at will. And then as you grow the number of consumers, your customers, it's very easy to add new because it's the same data just being replicated to more agents, and it's all identical, right? Performance layer. So we have Cassandra. So we publish the data to Cassandra. And then when the API receives a request for any of those views, the cache manager will check Redis. If the view is available there, returns right away. If not, brings from Cassandra, returns, and store on Redis. So why is that? Why are you using two powerful technologies for this, right? So Redis is in memory and has sub-second latency and high throughput. And this is ideal for dashboard files, relatively small files going to the dashboard. And Cassandra has high throughput for large files. So if a file is going to take several minutes to download, it doesn't matter latency because it takes half second or 5 seconds. It's the same if it's going to take like 10 minutes downloading, right? So that's why we put in this way. So the large files, we don't even allow to go to Cassandra because it's unlikely to be consumed by the dashboard. So this provides an extremely high performance for downloading and for the dashboard, right? So what's everybody who already built a UI, a system with UI, you know that this is where the customers are sensitive. So you want to make it as fast and as efficient as possible. That's why we adopted this approach. This is an example of the dashboards. We have the conventional one, heat maps and lines, whatever it is. And then this is the core, right? Here is where we combine the polygons, the maps, and all the metrics. On the right side, you see here switches where you can select which layer you want to see and overlap it on the map, right? In this case, we even have this that you can click and see the forecast. So this is rain in New York. If you click, you can see the rain moving northeast during the next few hours and days, right? So this is what I had for today. Thank you very much for attending. Is there any questions? All right, yeah. address what the customer needs. And then in the future, if the customer needs something even better or more specific, we can replace different components with other solutions. Not necessarily only IBM, whatever it is available. And so that's why we are approaching a more harmonic way in the considering how customers are thinking in terms of open source. Everybody's going open source, at least in the initial stage, right? Yes, please. Yeah, cognitive analytics is pretty much everything that you do based on prediction, right? Based on advanced, some kind of advanced mathematics. So here we are combining prediction, we are combining advanced analyst techniques, we are combining geometry, right, in terms of the polygons, the manipulation of polygons. So that is the context of cognitive. So the way IBM calls cognitive is everything around Watson, around predictive, being predictive. It's a subset. Redis, yes. Cassandra, not. We need to build another container for Cassandra. But yes, in production, we use Bluemix. I think we had them. Yes, please. Yeah, the quality is an issue before loading. So once you start having data that we call open data, right? So if you have data and you don't pay attention about what you are loading, by the time that we try to load the solution, you may have some trouble. It will not match well. So if we follow some rules in order to what to load and how to load, then it goes smoothly as you load to the internal tables. So quality control, the manual part is before you load data. And then after you load, we have automatic process to check, as I mentioned, overlap of polygons, double cities being loaded, same names. This is all checked automatically internally. Right. No, it's automatic. This part is, I didn't include because I knew we wouldn't have time. But there is one of the analytics that is, it's gone. So there is one of the analytics, it's called social analysis. And it's actually a group of analytics. One of them is automatic annotation. So we take anything that is written, can be a tweet, can be news, blogs, and then we automatically go through and identify if the author is talking about a particular product, right? So, and if it's talking good things or bad things. And we also try to infer if the author is a man, is a woman, age, right? So this is all automatic. So that's kind of natural language processing. That's also a subset of cognitive, right? So, and we apply this kind of techniques. We augment the initial body, like a tweet, augment with this and make this entire set, augmented set, available for analysis. Now the data scientists will take this augmented set and apply other levels of algorithms trying to figure out, yeah, there is a trend here, or something happened in the last week because we had a spike related to this class of the population. So we do this all automatically internally as part of advanced analytics. Yes, please.
Is visiting Starbucks, for example, which is a small entity in the corner of a particular business sometimes. How do you solve that customer visiting for Starbucks in a particular place? The Starbucks store.
Well, for example, the population movement that I showed, we would not be able to identify if he went just to Walmart or to the Starbucks, because it's by distance of one reference point. So we would identify, well, two things. If our customer is Walmart, we would identify that he went to that store. If our customer is Starbucks, then we would identify that he went to that store as well. Right? But we don't know if it's true either way. Right? So we don't have that differentiation right now at this, in terms of latitude, longitude, and where he went. But we are checking if he sends a tweet talking good things or bad things about the coffee, then that would be routed to Starbucks. If it's talking about a product at Walmart, that would be routed to Walmart. So we do have some method to identify this kind of situation, but it's not. The geographic aspect certainly is not accounted for that level of accuracy. We don't even have the means, right, to differentiate this. It's too close. Correct, exactly. So if the customer is providing that, then it's a new layer of data that we'll be incorporating.
That's a check-in, right? I mean, in the sense that I am in Starbucks. That's a kind of check-in service. But on the other hand, if I am using a mobile app, and so for example, Starbucks app, and that app is sending the latitude and longitude of that mobile device at that point, so I need to have a matching login of that latitude and longitude to the Starbucks store so that I can map that the user is in Starbucks.
That we have, right? That I showed you. So we know, given any point, any latitude, longitude, we can tell all the customers in a region that spent at least, let's say, 15 minutes around that coordinate during the last month. So that we have. And that's right. Correct. Exactly. That is right. That is right. We cannot do that yet, at least. We don't have the data for that. Another, maybe even a stressed problem related to this. Imagine that you have a mall with many shoppings close by. Now you are lost, right? You cannot tell any. Then would be good this, because now you know that the customer went there, and then we add this layer that you just described to understand, yeah, the customer went here, here, and here. Maybe in the future, he will come back to the same pattern, right? Oh, yeah. That's right, absolutely. Yeah. Yeah, so that's what I meant. We have a provider who tracks how their customers use the apps. So they collect this information from the apps, where the customers are using the apps, and now they know where the customers go, and then they aggregate. So it's all anonymous. We don't know who. We just know percentage of population moving with that pattern. Yes. Right.
So, for example, one for sales in the store, I aggregate the data for what tool or what specific tool do you use to aggregate all the data in, let's say, one result? I would get maybe a regression, but what do you use?
No, the aggregation first, in the first part, we don't change anything. We just make sure that we have the association of everything that is available to every single polygon in the map. And for London, for example, there are like 50,000 polygons, right? So we associate precisely everything that is available to polygons. Now, if we have stores, right, a chain, we associate the chain to the polygon, those metrics to that polygon becomes columns in addition to the conventional columns that you do for regression, for example. Now we imagine the conventional approach for advanced analytics, right? Imagine a table, every row is one store. You have your columns there, how much you made, size of the store, how many employees. And now we are adding a whole lot more columns here that's coming from this external data. So when you run the model now, your regression, grouping, whatever it is, now you have a whole lot more and meaningful because they are interconnecting with those and you can detect correlations between them, right? A lot richer data set.
Yeah, well, what I was trying to ask was, do you make, for example, weights, so for example, this variable, for example, fact. So this variable, how much impact did it have in the sales of this store in this location with this certain type of characteristics?
Yeah, depend on the use case, we would apply different techniques. But what you mentioned, regression is one of them, because you can identify which ones has the lowest p-value and eliminate the other ones. So that's what I meant. Once you add the external metrics, your set of drivers, the ones that are meaningful, change, right? So that is where magic happens, really, because you have a different set of what's important for the store.
Okay. Perfect. Thank you.
My pleasure.
I have another question.
Sorry. Sure, sure.
Mm-hmm. We don't have it at all.
I see.
So is it possible for tiny countries with not so detailed information to do this type of analysis? Or can
I think it is possible. If you don't have major cities, you could do it by hand. It's not that difficult. Imagine that you take one city and you put one guy, right, hire an intern, right? So, summertime. So, get this guy and divide the city in 1,000 polygons, right? And then next summer, you divide again and do it again, right? So right there, you have enough for a pretty good precision. Once you have the polygons, then you that's it. You have the latitude, longitude, and then you can apply this. Right? You can do it by hand. It's not as precise. We're talking about thousands and thousands for each city, right? But you could start, and then maybe once you have the first one, if you define the major regions of the city, once you have the base, you can apply some program to refine the base that you create by hand. Right? So that would work. No, no, we don't have that.
Great, accurate, but
All right. Good questions. Anything else? Okay. Yeah, there are different ways of doing this. One is if the city or the region is mentioned in the body. The other one is if the body is created in a particular region. For example, we are here and I issued a tweet about Dallas, right? So Dallas is mentioned in the tweet, so that should be part of Dallas context. But I'm here, so my lat long is in San Jose. So that's another reason to be in San Jose. So the same tweet can go to different place. Another possibility is I'm here, I'm talking about Dallas, but I live in Chicago. So that's another reason that that tweet should be associated to because I live in Chicago, right? So at least these three different ways to detect what is the tweet about, why I should consider the tweet, right? So this can be quite complex, depending on the situation. People may be talking about a game. So I mean, here, talk about a game in Kansas. The teams, one is from New York, another is from Florida, those sort of things. So it can become really complicated. Sure. Excellent question. In unbalanced? That's the beauty of NoSQL and advanced analytics. We don't have to have everything complete. So we load what is available. NoSQL takes it, right? So we handle that. We leverage and store everything that we can. And then depend on the use case, it's up to the data scientist to figure out if the data available can be used or not. Yeah, so two things, right? One is we take everything that's available. Whatever is available, we ingest and make it accessible in a way that is easy for the data scientists and for the users. So that's one stage. Now, if you are doing something that needs lots of data, you cannot have incomplete data, missing data, that is specific for the use case. So the data scientist needs to decide if he can or not use that particular data set. So we don't do that in advance. It will be case by case. For example, if you are doing clustering, maybe you can use this data set. If you are doing some kind of regression, maybe you cannot. The same data set would depend on the use case. So I'm not sure if I heard everything, but in terms of, you mentioned in terms of security, right? You mentioned in terms of access, having.
No, I mean, machine learning models.
Okay. I think I had trouble to follow the question itself. So there are many different algorithms that we apply, right? And the data is available for all the data scientists. So the data scientist needs to decide what to use. Now, they have a data set, complete data set for Dallas. So depending on what he wants to use, he will pick and choose the data set. If that's not, if one particular metric is not adequate, he needs to cut it. It's up to him to decide what to do with the data. Well, if the data is inadequate, then you cannot solve the problem. You don't have the data.
Or you can buy it.
Yeah. Probably that's a different kind of discussion, right? So we are not dealing with the analytic itself. There are other people dealing with the analytics. So
you are dealing with the inference.
Correct. Correct. So you guys have access to this presentation, right?
Yeah.
So I put the name of the guys developing those algorithms there at the bottom. So you can contact them. Or you can contact me and I introduce you. So my name is that if you put psdsouza@us.ibm.com. P as in Peter, S, D'Souza. At us.ibm.com, I will introduce you to them who are working on this. I work for GBS, Global Professional Services. Right? Sure.
Can I ask another question?
Sure, of course. Okay. Yes.
The question is, do we need to maintain the hierarchy explicitly in HBase? Because I could see there are L0, L1,
yeah.
L2 different levels being maintained as a different table at a particular level in the admin level, right?
Uh-huh.
The question is that because you have a pointing polygon library, which is kind of given a point, it can figure out where it belongs to.
Right.
The question is that do we need to maintain a separate table or different level in the HBase table? And what's the rational?
You don't need to have one table per level. You could put all of them because the row key for each one of the tables would be unique across tables.
Yeah.
But we thought it would be cleaner because otherwise we're going to start mixing similar columns inside the same table in different levels. So we thought maybe we should just split into the tables to make it cleaner. But it could be theoretically talking the same table. Now, why did we do in that way, having the polygons? Because of performance. We may have thousands and thousands of points. So if you do that in real time, it may be too slow for the UI, right? Yes.
The question is, Elasticsearch is also good for geospatial lookup as well as a data store because you are storing a lot of attributes in the HBase.
Right.
The question is that why not Elasticsearch doing both pointing polygon lookup as well as giving you the attributes that you are storing in HBase instead of HBase table?
It could. Depend on, there are many people working on this. It's a platform, right? So there are different data science, different teams working on this. So it, different people, they have followed different schools of approach in this. So it could, I think we could solve, maybe we could even change everything from HBase to Elasticsearch. There are people who would like to do it. But there are advantages keeping this way, right? It's cleaner, it's easier to understand, it's to, there are so
awesome.
Right? My pleasure. Excellent question. Thank you.
I love your presentation for real.
Thank
it's
you.
My favorite one, don't do that
one. All right.
I love it.
Thank you.
Nice to meet you.
My pleasure.
Thanks.
My pleasure. Anytime.
Yeah,
sure.
Where is the IBM team based on? Is here Almaden or something?
Oh, we have this. This is a project covering 8 different cities. We have people all over. We have four in the United States, 4 cities in the United States, people at IBM. And then we have 3 cities in India and Taiwan as well.
Okay, muchos parabéns por la presentación, por la conversa. The thing is, I'm IBMer too, and I work here in San Jose.
Ah,
so
really?
I'm related with Bikin, but that's not my real name. I'm working with another coworker here.
Okay.
But, you know, I was working geolocation, I was working now in big data, so I really like the project. I didn't know that IBM was doing something like this.
Yeah.
So it's really interesting. And, you know, I like the, and I think that my background fits perfect with all these ideas that you have here.
I see.
Improving that.
Cool.
So, do you have still vacancies for this project, or is something just oriented to the customer?
Yeah, we do have customers already. So this was based, we decided to make it a solution because of we already have one customer. So
okay.
The demand and has been very well accepted, right? So we are transforming this to a solution.
I mean, and the platform is really reusable for different customers. Said,
mm-hmm.
Right?
Oh, yeah.
At the end point, you can have different models for, that's really interesting. So there's, I mean, I have to check. I'll check for your name and check for the project. Let's see if there's any vacancy related, because it's really interesting.
Yeah, it is.
I'm fighting with Ambari and HBase, like backend level. Yeah, on my like master's project,